voltage. Ding! Righty. Hey! It's Fran again in the lab. Dot, 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 dot. Look at this. I couldn't let it sit. I went back to the drawing board. I pulled a third one of these display tubes, these Russian super big VFDs, and worked out a way to run it, although it was a lot of work because there turned out to be several issues to get around, notwithstanding the first being that a lot of the tubes just plain don't work. But it has re-inspired me to get back into the clock project, but I'm faced with some bigger build challenges than I originally had anticipated. I wanted it to be like an easy driver, so I wanted one transistor per segment, and with just about any other vacuflescent display, that would be more than adequate. In fact, because vacuflescent displays they're basically triodes, and any vacuflorescent display can be made into a very inefficient amplifier tube, but they're very bad at amplifying because the transconductance is very low. It's very low anode voltage, and the actual plates are very small. So that you add all this up and the transconductance is very low, so they usually, they don't really amplify so much, but you can use them as valves, and some companies have actually made little valves out of vacuflorescent displays with bigger plates and everything. But the difference between like a huge VFD like this little Russian tube, which is considered to be like a huge vacuflorescent display, the difference between this and this is like several many orders of magnitude. What makes this display so challenging to run is that the transconductance is so high. My simple one transistor driver, is more than adequate for just about any vacuflorescent display, including like these, but not for something like this, because it just wants to run away. Any segment that is not actually at ground, even if it has, as I found out just by bench testing, even if it's like a fraction of a volt over ground, the segments will begin to come on. So it was necessary to have a driver that would go rail to rail. So I knew I was gonna have to make a push-pull driver. But the push-pull control caused another problem, which is that I'm running this with an Atmel 2560, which is, 5 volts top. So you've got a huge disparity between the power supply voltage of the chip controlling and the voltage that you're trying to switch. And so that meant that I had to have another layer for a leveling transistor to be able to switch the push-pull pair on and off. So it ended up looking like this. This is what I built. Now this is times 8 per tube. So we got 8 of these for every tube, and so I got two 3904 NPN transistors and one 3906 PNP. This is the push-pull section here, and in order to control that, I had to use this NPN transistor, 3904, which is able to sink, it's able to sink that down, so I got a pull-up resistor here that's going to keep this push-pull output high, unless this is grounded. And so it's very easy. You can sync that to ground with only like 3.5 volts. So this is the workaround for the voltage discrepancy between the two power supplies, and also the fact that the output here for the plates, it's got to be either at 24 volts or it's got to be at ground. It can't be anywhere in between. Like I said, even if it's like a half a volt or a fraction of a volt above ground, those plates will come on. And yeah, so this is the filament transformer. I got 115 on one side, 5 volts on the other, and center tap down to ground. So when I do the 6 tubes, the filaments are going to be in series, AC filaments. So I'm going to be running a 30 volt transformer, so 5 times 6. So that's what I'm going to do for. And I have these big toroids. Where is that thing? This gorgeous toroidal transformer is going to be for the clock, the heart of the clock project. So yeah, it's going to be quite a big chunk of iron and copper. It's good hefty. So yeah, oof. And this is the last thing I wanted to show, the Achilles heel with the filaments. This is the one that had the open filaments, but the problem is down here where the pins interface with the traces. See, the traces, as I said in the last video, they're aluminized, but then on the filaments here, you can see on this, on the far right, this one is actually welded. You can see, I don't know if it'll show up on the HD, but there's actually a weld there, a little tack weld between the pin and a piece of foil that's going to that trace. That's welded, but on the other side where the filament attaches, it's not welded at all. It's actually just a physical contact point. They've got the pin here coming in under the glass, and that's just pushed underneath of a little piece of metal that's coming down off of the other rail. It's sort of exactly like what they're doing on the top side here. You can see this little, see that little whisker appendage right there? It's sort of the same thing. It's like a little contact spring, only it's, where is it? Right there, yeah. So it's kind of just shoved underneath that other pin. So that's actually just, I looked, you know, with magnification, there's no weld there. It's just a physical contact. So I don't know why they did that, if it's maybe because of thermal expansion, because maybe the rail that that's attached to, as it heats up, it has to slide a little bit, you know, or maybe, you know, it's probably moves around just for thermal expansion, so they had to make it some kind of a slidable contact, but that is the Achilles heel with the filaments, because once those two elements no longer make contact, well, that's it. So, oh well. All right, so yeah, this is the setup. I went back to the small transformer. I didn't really need the big one for this, but this is the board. I got, you know, one line of transistors on one side, and I got two on the other. So yeah, it's 24 transistors per tube for the display. I'm not looking forward to building up the driver board for 6 digits. But yeah, here we go. All right. Okay, so I stopped that down so you can see some of the artifacts. It's kind of hard to shoot it on video, but you can see right there. Okay. Filament voltage, let's see, I got right now it's at 5.2 volts. So the specific filament voltage really does a lot to change the appearance of the segment. So if I go down, I see that I'm just varying it here. So this is like, it's 4 volts to 5 volts. So let's see, that's, so it's, you can see the difference in the appearance of the segments as I vary the voltage. So here's 5 volts, and then between 5 and 5.5, you can see the change there, especially at the top. So this is one of my concerns about running multiple of these tubes. Is the exposure is the consistency of the illumination from segment to segment and from tube to tube, because if I'm running all the filaments together, the brightness of these tubes, they could vary a lot between from tube to tube just because of the variation in the transconductance of the various tubes. So there's probably going to be some tweaking involved in arranging the driver. It's probably not going to be so straightforward as just having every single tube have exactly the same setup. I might have to fudge it, but I don't want to do that. But it's just one of the peculiarities of a tube that, you know, has such high transconductance. So, yep. I'm going to get a close-up here. Yeah, so. I'm going to stop it down again. Yeah, there we go. Okay. Now, I stopped it down so that you can kind of highlight the variation in the segments here. So, hang on. All right. So, there you can see it's the bottom part of the tube. You can see the artifact here. That's the weird sort of splashing of electrons because of the spacing of the heaters. And you get this kind of weird dimpling effect. So again, that's 5 volts. If I go up to 5.5, you can sort of see it there. So yeah, see how it gets mottled? See, you get dark spots and stuff. This is just me I'm varying the voltage about a half a volt here. It's about a half a volt. So again, tolerance with these tubes, I imagine, is going to be an issue. I'm going to turn up the exposure again. Okay, give you. Now, obviously, if I put this behind a plexiglass, you know, like a tinted plexi, you wouldn't see any of the artifacts. But I want these tubes to be out in the open. I want them to be, you know, like that. So, yeah. All right. Yeah, it's just blaring, blaringly bright. I'll turn off this. Oh, jeez. Yeah, just. Man. It's really hard. It's hard to photograph something like this that's so bright. Okay, but anyway, you know, people are going to say, why have like 3 transistors for every segment? Why don't you just multiplex it? Blah, 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 blah. Well, the reason I don't want to multiplex is because of brightness, you know. Vacuum fluorescent displays, I mean, they can be multiplexed, but you sacrifice a lot of brightness, which for, you know, something like a desktop calculator or, you know, a clock on a microwave isn't a big deal. But, you know, if you want to have a clock that's going to be bright, especially like more in daylight, you don't really want to multiplex it. It's traditionally clocks, vacuum fluorescent clocks, always had direct drive. And they used to do that in the old days because before they had CMOS that would run at 24 volts, they used to run everything negative. So they'd have like the clock chip would run on negative 12 volts, and then the common would be at the plus 24 volt rail, and then it would just source high the output transistors, and then the filaments would be at negative 24 volts. So, but yeah, you with certain displays like LEDs, if you multiplex them, you know, you run them at or you overcurrent them, you know, because it's a very short period of time. So you have six displays. You're cutting by a factor of 6 the brightness, so you can up the current to get higher brightness because it's on for such a short period of time. But vacuum fluorescent displays, you can't do that because once the phosphors get saturated, you're limited to the anode voltage and also the filament voltage because you know the filaments only put out so much. You know, they're rated for a certain voltage. You can't like push the filament voltage. You know, it just isn't possible. So you hit a limit with the brightness after you've maxed out the filament current, and after, you know, and actually once you get the filaments about maxed out, you can put more and more anode voltage and you're not going to get any more brightness because the phosphors are saturated. That's it. So, you know, you hit a wall. And so, you know, traditionally, vacuum fluorescent clocks were always direct drive. And I wanted this to be direct drive with a little twist because I was going to, I have the grid is going to be a pulse width modulated so that I can do some interesting effects. I want to be able to control each segment individually, the brightness and such, not only so I can adjust the brightness of the whole clock, but also so that I can, you know, do some fading, you know, of the numbers and such. I want to do some interesting things with the clock that you don't really typically see in a vacuum fluorescent clock. All right. So I did go in and get another set of tubes, negotiated a decent price. I had to pay more this time, but for another lot of tubes. So hopefully between the two I can, you know, get six tubes that are all going to have the same brightness and have even illumination across the segments and everything like that. Hopefully. So anyway, thanks to all the patrons making all these videos possible, you know, allowing me to buy ridiculous tubes and present them to you. Yeah. So thank you everyone on the Patreon. Thank you. All right, I'm Fran. I'll be here at the bench, not with the clock project, but with something else, real soon. At the bench again.